Last week we did God versus the gods, where we looked at the previous week before that, we looked at the word Elohim, which is a Hebrew word. So when it says in the beginning, Elohim created the heaven and earth, so it's used for God. But there are a lot of other places where it's used for other things other than God. So for example, when it says, thou shalt have no other gods before me, that's Elohim. Thou shalt have no other Elohim before me. Or whenever they talk about they worship other gods, that word is Elohim as well. So it's used for God with it, when it's a capital E. I mean, it don't show either in our Bible. So basically like us, we have a capital G for God and a lowercase g for gods. So Elohim is used in the same way. So last week we looked at God versus the gods. So we looked at an example of God delegating judgment to other beings, the sons of God. In Psalms 82, he criticized the Elohim, sons of God, for judging unfairly. And we previously saw that that term is used to refer to the pagan gods as well. And Paul said that these were demons that the people were worshiping. And last week we looked at, God said one of the reasons for the 10 plagues of Egypt was to bring judgment upon the Egyptian gods, or Elohim. So it wasn't just for Pharaoh. We saw that he hardened Pharaoh's heart. So Pharaoh couldn't be judged by it because God caused his heart to be hardened, but it was judged of the Egyptian gods. We saw that another reason for the captivity was an escape was to show an example of the nations that God was superior to the gods that they were worshiping. Because all the nations heard about it, and all the other nations were saying, you know, how great the Israelites' gods were after hearing about what had happened. And the final reason were for God to display the miracles to draw the Israelites back to him, because they were worshiping other gods. And then we ended, we saw the fact that Jesus was going to be placed above all of these other gods was hidden from them, Paul says, until after his death. So they didn't know that by killing him that that was going to place Jesus, ruler of the earth and above everything. All right. So this week we're going to look at the Jews, sons of God. So the Jews, the sons of God. So Deuteronomy 14, 1 through 2 says, you are the sons of the Lord your God. You shall not cut yourself nor shave your forehead for the sake of the dead. You are a holy people to the Lord your God. And the Lord has chosen you to be a people of his own possession out of all the peoples of the face of the earth. So God chose the Israelites to be a special people. So we're going to go through and we're going to look at basically the history from the beginning leading up to God choosing the Israelites. So from the beginning of the world to God choosing the Israelites, we're going to just briefly look at what happened there. Look at Israel as the sons of God. We're going to look at the law of Moses, and Israel as judge. We're going to look at Israel's forgotten mission. So a mission that God gave the Jews that is rarely talked about. I've never heard it talked about. Then we're going to see the fall of Israel and their future redemption. All right. So, go through the history of the world, history up to Abraham. This is from a supernatural viewpoint, I guess, we'll look at. So, the first started off with Adam, and in Luke chapter 3, from 23 on, it gives the genealogy of Adam. So I'm just going to read some of it. It says, now Jesus himself was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. He was a son, so it was thought, of Joseph, the son of Heli. Then it goes on and on and on to 38. The son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. So it says Adam was the son of God. So Adam was the first human son of God. And so as the son of God, Adam was given dominion over all of the earth. So Adam was a son of God. He was given dominion over all of the earth. And then Adam fell. And then things continue. And then Genesis 6 talks about, so this is just kind of going to go through the history, talks about the sons of God came to the daughters of men, and so God wasn't happy about that. And so we had the flood, destroyed the earth, and then Noah's family was there. So Noah's family was told to replenish the earth. So in Genesis 10, it lists out Noah's line, which are 70 nations were named there. So they started 70 nations. So he started over. So Adam didn't work out. Then something else happened. And then Noah's line came. So it's like, we're going to start over with Noah. But then they fell at the Tower of Babel. So the nation started following after other gods, or they wanted to build a structures whose top reached the heaven. And so we'll actually get into more detail about those two. So the with the Moses, Noah's time, the sons of God and daughters of women, that'll be the one of the future sons of God studies we'll look at. And then the Tower of Babel, so they fell, and then so God basically turned the nations over to worship any other gods. And so then he went to go find a nation for himself. And so that's when he chose Abraham. So he chose Abraham to be a people to worship him alone. And let's see, you have Genesis 12, 1 through 3.
Mm-hmm. The Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the people on the earth will be blessed through you.
Okay, so you wanted to start a new nation with Abraham, or Abram at the time. And he said, all the nations will be blessed through Abraham. So how were all the nations blessed through Abram?
Well, his descendants, Jesus was...
Exactly, yes, right. So that's the line that brought Jesus. So all the world was blessed through him. And so, yeah, when I read this again, I saw it said, those you bless... He'll bless, and whoever you curse, I will curse. I'm like, well, that's pretty cool. whoever I curse, God will back me up. Whoever I bless, God will back me up. Kind of reminds me, I was listening to a talk about Elijah on the way here, and how they say God, he caused the water to stop. So Elijah caused the water to stop. But he was saying that there was nowhere in the Bible that God told him to do that. So he basically read the scripture and decided that's what he should do. But God didn't tell him to do it. But then God backed him up with it. So he decided, I'm going to cause a flood, you know, no more rain. And God was like, okay, well, that's what we'll do then. I was like, yeah, that'd be pretty good. Let's see. So Abraham, one interesting note, Abraham was a Hebrew, it says in Genesis. Abraham was a Hebrew. But interesting thing, which I kind of never thought of, is that he was a Hebrew. So all the Israelites and the Jews were chosen because he chose Abraham. Mm-hmm. Abraham was a Hebrew, which means he wasn't the only Hebrew. Because the Hebrews were the sons of, it was Eber, who was like two or three people up. So that means that all of the Hebrews weren't the chosen people, because they weren't all descendants of Abraham, which is something interesting I realized. He was a Hebrew, so there were Hebrews that weren't descendants of Abraham. So then we say, well, why did he choose Abraham? You have Isaiah 45, 4 through 5. Mm-hmm.
And why have I called you for this work? Why did I call you by name when you did not know me? It is not for the sake of Jacob my servant. Sorry. It is for the sake of Jacob my servant, Israel my chosen one. I am the Lord. There is no other God. I have equipped you for battle, though you don't even know me.
Okay, so he says it was for the sake of Jacob. Mm-hmm. And so there's a few places where it talks about, or alludes to the fact that Jacob was the reason that he did all that. So Jacob, who later became Israel. Mm-hmm. So Abraham was chosen because he was going to have Jacob, or have Isaac, who had Jacob. Mm-hmm. So Jacob was the special one. You know, he said, Jacob I loved and Esau I hated. Mm-hmm. So Jacob was the one. I don't know why, but that was just what that's a long story. So it's like Jacob was the special reason for that whole line, kind of. Mm-hmm. And he loved Jacob before he was in his mother's womb, so it was something special about Jacob that he saw, that he chose to make the Jewish race because of Jacob.
Yeah, I recently found something about Jacob and Esau, the comparison online, and I found there it said that Esau kind of despised holy and sacred things. In the time of the Jews back then, it was the birthright, was considered something very special, of extraordinary value, and you don't just give that away for quick carnal pleasure, like a meal, Esau did.
Right.
That's basically, God was unhappy with him about such things.
Yeah, the birthright is, he got the firstborn, blessing of the firstborn son, even though he wasn't a firstborn. Yeah, and the birthright was something special. The firstborn birthright was something cherished. And good point. And I guess one of the things about Jacob, when Jacob wrestled with God, it was kind of, you know, he was a trickster and all of that. But then at some point he wrestled with God, and it was kind of like, well, he wrestled with God, is that a good thing? You know, that's a bad thing. But basically, you know, he said, though, I'm not going to let go until you bless me. So he tricked his brother out of the blessing with the food. And then he tricked with the fur on his arm, made him think. So he was a trickery. He was doing trickery to try to get things. But then at some point in his life, he said, I'm going to turn to God. I'm not going to let go of you until you bless me. So it's kind of like shows the faith. Because like if we get in a problem and then, we say, oh, how can I fix it? You know, if we get to the point where we say, I'm just going to press on God to solve the solution. I'm not going to try to figure it out myself. I'm not going to look for anything. I'm only going to, God, you'd have to fix this. And that just showed faith and strong faith. So that was the reason I think Israel was so special, because he, even like David had all kind of mess ups and sins, but David always turned back to God whenever he got in trouble, he turned to God. Mm-hmm. They stopped trying to figure it out on their own, and they had complete faith in God. Mm-hmm. So they had, it's like, they weren't praying saying, oh, I hope God will do it, but, I lost my job, I hope God will do it, but let me, hedge my bets by doing this, doing that, doing that. It looks like they had full faith that, okay, God was going to do it. Mm-hmm. And so it was like, okay, I'm going to put aside any other, I'm just going to go to God for it. And I know that he's going to deliver. I just have to keep asking him.
And we don't see Esau ever doing that.
Right. Esau never had any relationship with God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so Jacob finally turned to that point, and then God changed his name. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's see. So Jacob became Israel, and his offspring became the sons of God. You have Exodus 4:21-23.
The Lord said to Moses, when you return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I have given you the power to do. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Then say to Pharaoh, this is what the Lord says. Israel is my firstborn son, and I told you, let my son go so he may worship me. But you refused to let him go, So I will kill your firstborn son.
Okay, so Israel is God's firstborn son. So we see here that he hardened Pharaoh's heart so Pharaoh wouldn't have a choice but to not let them go. So he wanted to make sure that he got to do the miracles and got to show the plagues and show these things for those other reasons. But he says Israel is his firstborn son, even though we see Adam was his son. So firstborn is similar to Israel or Jacob. He got the blessing of the firstborn son, even though he wasn't really the firstborn. He got the firstborn son's blessing. Mm-hmm. So Israel got the firstborn's blessing. Israel was God's firstborn son. Mm-hmm.
In a sense, you could say, because Pharaoh didn't release God's firstborn, mm-hmm. which is Israel,
right.
God took Pharaoh's firstborn, the firstborn of each Egyptian family.
Yes, during the...
As a return.
Yeah. Yeah, after the Passover. Yeah, so it was, you're going to take my firstborn son, I'm going to take yours. Mm-hmm. And so, interesting that you had a thing about firstborn. So I have something. It was on whyisrael.org about the firstborn. It says, the firstborn sons in the Old Testament were not just the heir. He himself was sanctified. That means he is set apart as God's possession. He must be given to the Lord, Exodus 22:29, because he is the Lord's possession. He must be redeemed. But instead of all firstborns of Israel, God now designates one tribe to be priest for him. So he designated the Levites. They constitute, as it were, the link between God and the nation. So Israel, out of all nations, designated to the kingdom of priests and a holy nation before God. Well, you have Exodus 19, mm-hmm. 5 through 6.
Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on earth, for all the earth belongs to me. And you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. This is the message you must give to the people of Israel.
Right, so the Israel became the priest to all of the world, the nations. So the priest, the high priest, would take the prayers of the Israelites to God. So Israel became the intermediary for the rest of the world, for God at that time. So Israel became the priest for the rest of the nations. Let's see. Any thoughts? Okay. So now we'll look at Israel as judge. So the Israelites they got the law. And so then the question is, were the Gentiles, so the Jews got, Moses gave them 613 different laws. Mm-hmm. So the question was everybody supposed to follow those laws or just the Jews? So give a quick background, kind of an aside. So the Jewish text, so we know that the Torah is called the law, mm-hmm. which is the five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So the Torah is the five books of the law, but the Jewish also have a book called the Tanakh, which is the Hebrew Bible, which is basically pretty much our Old Testament. So it's the Torah, the five books of the law, the Nevi'im, the prophets, and then the Ketuvim, the writings, so the Songs of Solomon and all the others. So that's pretty much the Old Testament. That's the Hebrew Bible. And then they have another book called the Talmud, which is the center of Rabbinic Judaism, which is most of Judaism today, which has the Mishnah. So they say that there was a law that Moses gave. I mean, that God gave to Moses and he wrote in the Old Testament. But then they say there was also laws that he gave that Moses didn't write. and they call it the oral Torah. And so initially they didn't write any of the things down. Then at some point Moses wrote down the five books of law. So they said there was an oral Torah, there were books that stuff or laws that Moses didn't write. And they didn't write them down until like after the second temple when they were starting to get destroyed, they decided to write all the writings. So it has the oral Torah, which is called a Mishnah, and a Gemara, which are basically like commentaries on the Mishnah. And so those are considered their holy books. And so I guess the reason I bring that up is so they had something that they call the seven laws of Noah. And so the Jews believe that God gave, when Noah's family was created, he gave them laws to follow too, and the seven laws of Noah. And so the Jews feel that the non-Jewish people were supposed to follow these seven laws. So they had to follow the 613 laws God gave them. But everybody else wasn't accountable for those laws. But they're accountable for the seven laws of Noah. So the seven laws, so their Jewish belief is that if you follow these seven laws of Noah, then you be assured a place in the world to come, is what they call heaven. So they fit, if you're not a Jew and you follow the seven laws, then you'll be assured a place in the world to come. And their seven laws are, one, do not deny God. Two, do not blaspheme God. Three, do not murder. Do not engage in illicit sexual relations. Do not steal. Do not eat a live animal. And establish courts, legal systems to ensure obedience of the law. So that's from their Talmud. So whether, you know, we should consider the Talmud is up for debate because it's not part of our Bible. Mm-hmm. But so this is the Jewish belief. And so the seven Noahide laws are what they call. And so Noahidism is a religion. And the symbol for that religion, so what was a symbol that could be related to Noah? Do you think of any symbols related to Noah? Or a symbol that God gave Noah?
A rainbow.
So that's the symbol of Noahidism, is a rainbow. I don't know, it's kind of a question. But so let's see. As a rabbi, Wayne Allen says, salvation is achieved through noble action rather than through the acceptance of a particular religious doctrine. So that was their belief. And so we'll look at judging the nation. Israel role as judging. So judging the nations. You have Deuteronomy 17, 2 through 5.
If a man or woman living among you in one of the towns the Lord gives you is found doing evil in the eyes of the Lord your God, in violation of his covenant, and contrary to my command has worshipped other gods, bowing down to them or to the sun or the moon or the stars in the sky, and this has been brought to your attention, then you must investigate it thoroughly. If it is true, and it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done in Israel, take the man or woman who has done this evil deed to your city gate and stone that person to death.
Slap on the hand. No. It was pretty pretty severe. So it says if a man or a woman living among you, so that's a non-Jew. So if there's a non-Jew who's doing something like worshiping another god, then they're supposed to kill them. So they were supposed to pass judgment. So this specific passage is talking about in Israel or in their land. Mm-hmm. So they talks about dominion in their land. So they had a role of judging as well and passing judgment. So this is specifically talking about in their land. One thing I forgot to mention about the Noahide laws is when I was found it, and when I was studying that, I saw something interesting in that. some writings that Congress had gave, I guess, you know, they recognized people all the time, but they recognized this one rabbi, and in the writing of the letter they presented or they gave him, it was written that our country was founded on the Noahide laws.
Yeah.
That was Congress, something that Congress wrote. And that was kind of interesting. So, yeah, interesting. So, yeah, so that would get interesting because they don't consider Jesus God. So if you're worshiping Jesus, you'll be worshiping another God. So, I don't know. Interesting food for thought. Okay, so now we'll get to the Jews' forgotten mission. So it was a mission that God gave the Jews, which is rarely talked about. So I'll start with Isaiah 42, 6-7. It says, I, the Lord, have called you to righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light to the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. So what darkness were the Gentiles sitting in? In their sin. Mm-hmm. So the light they were going to show them was to bring them to God. And so Israel was supposed to free them from bondage, to show them to God. Let's see, you have Isaiah 49:6.
He says, you will do more than the restore the people of Israel to me. I will make you a light to the Gentiles, and you will bring my salvation to the ends of the earth.
Right. So God told them in multiple places that they were supposed to bring a light to the Gentiles and bring the Gentiles to salvation by bringing the Gentiles to God. So the Jews had a mission of drawing non-Jews to God. Mm-hmm. But you don't hear that talked about too much. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the missions that God gave the Jews. So this implies encouraging them to follow God, the true God, you know, and to stop following the pagan gods. Not necessarily converting to Judaism, but following God. Mm-hmm. And so they call it proselytizing. So it's not evangelism. Evangelism, I guess, is specifically for Christianity. So proselytizing was heavily practiced. In 1,000 years prior to Jesus, it was like a big thing. They were out trying to convert people, trying to bring them over to God. But then it died down. But they were supposed to. And then, let's see. So I have a quote from this Reformed Jew. It says, since the philosophy of Judaism essentially excludes the belief of eternal torment for sinners, and instead believes that sinners can successfully repent if they're sincere, that everyone will benefit in the world to come, there's no need to save others by converting them to Judaism. So that was kind of in defense of someone asking them why they don't proselytize more or evangelize more. But it's clearly said in the Bible that that's what they're supposed to do. And then we'll look at a couple more examples of it, and we'll look at the law. So the law itself, we'll see how that was even supposed to be a tool for that. You have Deuteronomy 4:5-8.
See, I have taught you decrees and laws as the Lord my God commanded me, so that you may follow them in the land you are entering to take possession of it. Observe them carefully, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. What other nation is so great as to have their gods near them the way the Lord our God is near us whenever we pray to him? And what other nation is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as this body of laws I am setting before you today?
So when God gave them the laws, the nations were supposed to look at them and go, wow, they're full of wisdom and understanding because of the laws they give. And it was like, oh, well, they have a righteous God because these are righteous laws. So apparently they had unrighteous laws. And there's, so that was supposed to draw them towards them. They're supposed to look at the laws and see how great and wise they were because of these laws. And so it was supposed to be obvious that these were wise laws and good laws. Now read Deuteronomy 28:9-14. It says, the Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath. If you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience, then all the people of the earth will see that you are called by my name and of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Lord will grant you abundant prosperity in the fruit of your womb, so they would have a lot of descendants, the young of your livestock, they would have healthy cattle, and the crops of your ground in the land he swore to your ancestors to give. The Lord will open heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in season and bless all the works of your hand. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. The Lord will make you head, not the tail. If you pay attention to the commands the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be on top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left. Follow other gods and serving them. So the laws God gave them, if they followed the laws, so we saw earlier that it was people were going to see how wise these laws were and how righteous they were, but also the laws were supposed to give them a great outcome. It's going to give them better crop, give them better livestock. And so by following the laws, not only are they going to have show that they have supernatural wisdom, but they would have other advantages. So they followed the laws, they would, the health laws were supposed to be in, show them living longer. Mm-hmm. The agricultural laws would give them better crops, you know, the Jubilee, the 7th year rest. Now the farmers know that they have to do that now, you know, you have to grow for a certain time and then maybe at one season don't plant on it. So the Jews were the only one doing that. So the laws he gave them were supposed to be an example to have better outcome, and then he was going to bless them with rain and bless their cattle. And so people were, it was supposed to be an example for people to look at it and go, man, they got a good God. Maybe we should follow him. So circumcision, the Sabbath day rest, worship of an invisible God, abstinence from certain foods, financial stewardship, and agricultural practices were all supposed to be aspects of their lifestyle that set them apart and gave them better results. So the goal of following the law and the benefits you gain in areas of life would convince others to do things God's way. Living by wisdom, God would show others that your God was superior to theirs. And that's kind of one of the thing referred to as the kingdom of God. When Jesus talks about the kingdom of God is here, you know, that was one of his main messages, was the kingdom of God. So he talked about salvation and eternal life, but he talked about the kingdom of God. And if you study that, and we'll probably do another study on that, the kingdom of God wasn't something that came later, because he talked about the kingdom of God is upon us, the kingdom of God is upon us. So he didn't say the kingdom of God will be upon you when you die. And, you know, it's when you get saved, you're supposed to come into some things by following the laws and following example that become an example for others. And, so we'll get into that some other time. So the law themselves were supposed to, among other things, win people over to God. So we saw the Jews had a mission to win people over to God, and the law was one of the things that was supposed to do that. So now we'll look and see if that's what they did. All right, so I'll read Isaiah 1:2. Listen, O heavens, and hear, O earth, for the Lord speaks. Sons I have reared and brought up, but they have revolted against me. So, like it didn't happen. You have Acts 7, 39 to 42. Yes.
But our ancestors refused to listen to Moses. They rejected him and wanted to return to Egypt. They told Aaron, "Make us some gods who can lead us, for we don't know what has become of this Moses who brought us out of Egypt." So they made an idol shaped like a calf, and they sacrificed to it and celebrated over this thing they had made. Then God turned away from them and abandoned them to serve the stars of heaven as their gods. In the book of the prophets it is written, Was it to me you were bringing sacrifices and offerings during those 40 years in the wilderness, Israel?"
So we see at that time Israel turned to other gods. And then if you read the Old Testament, it's just a continual spiral of they turn to other gods, God does something, wins them back. They turn to other gods, God does something, wins them back. And they just keep turning to these other gods until at some point God he splits Israel up, the temples get destroyed, and they keep going back. And Gideon goes and wins a battle, and they're good for a while. Gideon dies, they go back to worshiping Baal. It's just a continuous cycle. So that was the past. Now we'll get to Paul, and we'll get to the current situation. So I'll read Romans 11, 2 through 8. It says, "God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what scripture says about the passage about Elijah? How he appealed to God against Israel. 'Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I'm the only one left, and they are trying to kill me.' So it was a time when so many of Israel had turned to worship in Baal that Elijah thought he was the only Israelite left, the single person. He literally thought he was the only one left that was serving God. And God says, and God's answer to him, "I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed a knee to Baal." So he kept 7,000. So God reserved to himself 7,000. And so that was 1% of Israelite at the time. So 99% were worshiping Baal of the northern kingdom. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. So God chose 7,000 to single out back then, and so too at the present time there's a remnant chosen by grace. "And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. So there's some that presently God has chosen out. What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. The elect among them did, but the others were hardened, as it is written. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see and ears that could not hear, to this very day." So it's saying back then, when they all turned to Baal, God gave them. So what's the spirit of stupor? Is it a spirit to make you do
spiritual blindness?
Yes, spiritual blindness. So a spirit that makes you stupid. No, but so God made it so they couldn't see. So God had hardened Pharaoh's heart, and God hardened them, their eyes, that they didn't turn to God. So then the question is why would God do that? But it says, Oh, doesn't say that yet. Okay, we're going to get to that. We're going to get to why God would do that. So, let's see. Romans 11, now 11 through 15. It says, again I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. So because they fail, salvation is now turned to us. So Paul started speaking to the Jews. They wouldn't listen. So Paul turned to us. But if their transgression means riches for the world and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their full inclusion bring? So since they lost out, now we were the recipients of the grace, because now God, through Jesus, we can go to God. Say, I am talking to you Gentiles, and as much as I am the apostle to the Gentiles, I take pride in my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. For if their rejection brought reconciliation to the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? So it says Gentiles will be jealous because we're receiving salvation.
The Jews.
The Jews will be jealous because we're receiving salvation. And he says we're receiving the riches. And so the fall of the Jews is what partially allowed us to be saved. So the fall of the Jews and salvation. And so Paul said he hopes that our salvation will make them envious and turn them back to God. Okay, so then we'll read on. It says, Romans 11, 25 through 32. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery. So when Paul talks about mysteries, it's generally something that they didn't know before that time. So like the mystery of, you know, Christ was going to save the world, or Christ had to die. They didn't know that until. I don't want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved. So Israel's hearts were hardened. So God hardened their hearts to not accept Christ. But in this way, no, it says until the full number of Gentiles come in. So until all of the Gentiles come in, and it says in this way, Israel will be saved. So then we'll look at that. Well, how will they be saved? So it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will turn godlessness away from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them. When I take away their sins, as far as the gospel is concerned, they are enemies for your sake. But as far as election is concerned, so when he's talking about the elect Jews, they are loved on account of the patriarchs. So on account of Abraham, Isaac, for God's gift and his calls are irrevocable. Just as you were at one time disobedient to God, have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience, so they too have now become disobedient. So we receive mercy because we were, or when we were disobedient, and they too now become disobedient, so now they're disobedient, in order that they too may receive mercy for, as a result of God's mercy. For God has bound everyone over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. So if he turned them over to disobedience and hardened them so he could have mercy, so it's kind of like, well, how can that be? But, you know, kind of like when we saw the Egyptians, the plagues were judgment on the Egyptian gods. It wasn't against Pharaoh because God hardened Pharaoh's heart. So you couldn't blame Pharaoh because God did that. So if God hardened their hearts, then they can still have grace. So if they had the option to choose and they chose wrongly, then they wouldn't have any hope. But if God hardened their hearts so they wouldn't choose, then they can be blameless still. So that's what Paul is saying, that the Jews that don't choose Jesus, God has hardened their hearts, so they won't be accountable to the result of that. And so there are an elect, which God pulled out, that will follow Jesus, but the rest will be blameless, according to Paul. So there's hope.
Yes.
All right, now let's see. Any thoughts before the conclusion? No.
That's a new thought. I've never heard of that about the Egyptians.
Oh.
That they are not being held accountable when their heart was hardened.
Oh, Pharaoh's heart.
Oh, Pharaoh's heart,
yeah,
yes.
Pharaoh wasn't being held. Yeah. Well, yeah. I guess he was probably accountable for a bunch of other stuff, though. But not for not letting them go at that time. Let's see. All right, so the conclusion. Adam was the first son of God, so God gave him dominion over all the earth. When he fell, he lost that dominion. God eventually chose Abraham and the descendants of Jacob to be his new sons. God's goal of choosing the Jews wasn't to create an exclusive club, but Israel was supposed to serve as priests and judges. As priests, they would intermediate between God and the Gentiles. As judges, they were supposed to judge Jews and Gentiles within the Holy Land. Another role that's rarely discussed is that the Jews were supposed to draw the Gentiles to God. God gave them the laws on how to live and made them a peculiar people that noticeably stood out. By living under these laws, the Jews were supposed to be seen as wise, because they would have visibly better results. They would have better health, better financial success, and other reward from following these laws. And this would entice the other nations to come and serve God, the one true God. Then if we look in, Jesus said in Matthew 28:19, he told his followers, go out and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So it seems that the mission hasn't changed to make disciples. And so if the Jews didn't do it, so we saw that Adam fell, so then God chose, you know, another people. Then in Noah's time, the sons of God had a falling, so God wiped away the earth and chose Noah. And then they fell at the Tower of Babel, so God turned them over and chose Abraham and started over. And so then the Jews didn't accomplish it. So if the Jews didn't do it, now it's up to the new sons of God, which are us. And that's that.
Very good.
That'll be one of our future lessons, other sons of God's lessons. So we have a few sons of God lessons coming up. Walking away, let's seek the truth and let's be light.
Okay.
Good night.
Good night. Thank you.